we're rounding out our first weekend of season 10, and in some ways, we're just getting started. I'm Emily. This is Caitlin. We're the co-founders of the festival, but you already knew that, right?
You're asking me? I knew that.
You're so funny.
Thanks. You know what else is funny? Peacock's new original series, We Are Lady Parts, which is why we're here right now.
Yes, it turns out a comedy about a Muslim female punk band with a killer soundtrack is exactly what 2021 needed. And we're so excited for you to meet all these incredible cast members and the creator.
Also, if you hadn't had a chance to check the show out yet, you can do that right now after the panel. All six episodes from the first season are available now on Peacock, and it is extremely worth your time.
With that, we're going to pass the mic to our wonderful moderator, Vanity Fair's Sonia Soraya, to let her take it away.
Hey, guys. Hi. Thanks so much for having me. Okay. I'm so excited to talk about this show, which was like my whole high school experience revisited. Okay, I'm going to introduce our amazing panel. We have the creator and director and writer of the show, Nida Manzoor. Anjana Vasan, who plays Amina. Sarah Kameela Impey, who plays Syra. Faith Omole, who plays Bisma. Juliette Motamed, who plays Aisha. And Lucie Shorthouse, who plays Mumdaz. Hi, guys.
Hi.
Hi, how are you? I wore my Bowie earrings. That was my sense of
love. Yes. Energy, love it.
It just premiered on Channel 4, right? Okay, so how was it to see it?
It's a relief, because it's been a long time in the making. So I'm just glad that it's out there finally, out there in the universe. And, you know, we're all very proud of the show and we love the show. And I just hope that people respond to it the way I think the show deserves.
Yeah. How long has it been in the making for?
I mean, Nida will say, you know, obviously she sat with it for much longer than we have, but the comedy short was 2 years ago that we did for a Channel 4.
Yeah.
And then we were meant to film just when the pandemic hit. And then we managed to film it somehow really safely over the last year. And it's finally out. But I'm sure Nida can tell you about when she first had the idea, which was years before that.
Yeah, Nida, please take it away.
Yeah, hi. I had the idea, I think around 5 years ago. Mm-hmm. The initial idea, and it's basically been since then until now kind of finding, you know, the right people to make it with, and also sort of finding within myself what I wanted to say with the story. So it's been, you know, a good gestation period, but I'm like, as Ange was saying, just so thrilled that it's out there in the world. I watched it with my mom, my family last night, and my mom was like just giggling like this. She has like throughout, and I was validated by her giggles. I just like sat there next to her being like, keep giggling.
I think like one of the questions that I have for you as the creator, I mean, I saw in the credits that you did some of the songs, recorded them, wrote them. And I wanted to know a little bit about how, I mean, first of all, how you came to like pop punk or punk and in like your like formative years, but then also, you know, recording these songs with your family, is that right? Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
I wrote the songs with my brother Shez and my sister Sonia and my brother-in-law Benny. We all kind of spent a week together in a studio in King's Cross, just kind of spitballing ideas. You know, my brother plays all the instruments. I play guitar, my sister plays bass. So we were like just trying to work it out between us in a very organic way. We've been making music together since we were tiny. Mm-hmm. So it's very, you know, one of the most exciting things about making the show was that I get to do that with my siblings. And they're just, you know, we share a sense of humor and we just share a taste in music. You know, growing up, music was so important to me in my household. My dad was a big sort of music lover, and that was everything from folksy Simon and Garfunkel to sort of Sufi Kavali music and stuff. So he had all these influences that were kind of trickling down to us. And in terms of punk, I was actually much more like Amina's character. I was obsessed with Paul Simon. Like, I was a diehard Paul Simon fan. One of my longest diary entries is about my obsession with Paul Simon. It's actually quite disturbing.
Can we get one quote?
Literally, it's like the best day of my life so far, .. to the ticket. It's like, I love him. Okay, anyway, that's a separate. But my sister was a massive punk. You know, she was into, you know, the Green Day, Blink 182. She was all about that life. And that definitely also spoke to me. She would take me with her to gigs, to like Newfound Glory, you know, the American punk, pop punk that was happening. I really loved System of a Down. They became my favorite just because they had that kind of Mediterranean, Middle Eastern sound to their music. And it just felt like it was bringing different parts of their identity to a punk sound. Mm-hmm. Or, you know, so yes, music was big.
Yeah. Well, and I would love to hear, okay, so I'd love to hear from the cast, because I feel like, I first of all want to know about like your own feelings about like punk music or like the music of We Are Lady Parts, and then and if it was like a shift for you to like get into the punk mode.
You go, Sarah, you go.
No, I was gonna say that I love every single word, every single note in the Lady Parts punk music. It's very different to anything that I had played before or sung. I was in a band like a little while ago and we sang kind of soul indie music. Mm. So when it came to singing punk, I'd never experienced that. And there's something where you have to really let go and just let yourself be loud and not care about the notes. So to do that together was so liberating. Like, it really bonded us because you got to like make lots of mistakes, be a bit weird, like get it out there and just scream. We screamed a lot and it's so therapeutic. I recommend it to everyone. Someone can scream. It's brilliant. Yeah, love it. So catchy too. It's in my head.
Anyone else?
I've never really listened to any punk or anything, and I don't think I really understood what was happening until I was like in the room and it was like, okay, go with the songs. And then like Sarah starts performing and I'm like, right, let's go there. Like, let's just do it. But I, like Sarah said, the energy between us is just so amazing. And like this chemistry that we feel so safe together that we just kind of go for it together. And some of the performances that these girls would do singing these songs, you'd be like, are you okay, hon? Like, it was just ridiculously amazing. And the songs are so catchy. My family is like texting me. They've started listening to all the songs on Spotify. Like, they're obsessed. Everyone's obsessed. And they're like, I didn't know I like punk. I'm like, you do now.
For myself and for Amina, like, I actually share the same, I guess, Spotify playlist as Amina. Weirdly, I'm also a country and Western music obsessive. I love American folk music. So when Nida said, you know, this character's going to have a little homage to O Brother, Where Art Thou in the first episode, I was like, I'm sold. I'm there. And we had a lot of fun sort of deciding who the posters would be on in Amina's closet, her little like shrine to her like folk music heroes. And like, I definitely wanted Pete Seeger in there because for me, it was like, that was one of my heroes growing up. So it was, I guess for her, she's so far away from the idea of punk in every sense of the word when you first see her. But then obviously her journey of self-confidence also mirrors the like the musical journey of the show. And I think she realizes that maybe she's a little bit more, she's got a bit more punk in her than she realizes.
Oh yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
For me, it was like this really, like kind of like the opposite of you guys actually. Like, I grew up very much in punk bands. Like, that was my ish, like I loved it. Like, I literally used to play bass in like a punk band with some girls from school and we were all like, guys, like you gotta express yourself and like stick it to the man. Like, so, like when this script came through, I genuinely was like, can I say no to this? I don't think so. Like, it just seemed so like fate had just came down and handed me some drumsticks. It was kind of crazy.
Yeah, like, let's talk casting, because I feel like that must have been a fascinating, I mean, for all of you, it must have been fascinating. I know, Nida, you must have had something in mind for all of the characters, but also you're looking for people who play specific instruments and then who are also fulfilling like specific, I mean, I got the sense that every character had a backstory that was very specific, like they have a certain ethnic backstory and like religious observance and stuff. And so it must have been interesting to like be matching those things. Tell me a little bit about that process for you guys.
Yeah, actually, Sonia, a lot of the actors didn't play their instruments.
Yeah.
My brother...
I was fooled, just to be clear.
Okay. Oh, really? my brother Shez, who scored the show, also taught everyone how to sort of play the instruments, play the parts, and you know, these incredible actors worked so hard that by the end of it, they were able to actually play the song. So you guys, I'm sure, will speak to that, because you smashed it. And part of the casting process was also seeing how their sort of punk musicality, and also if they can pick up an instrument. And you know, my brother, we had time booked in for rehearsals for that. In terms of the other kind of casting, it was so, for me, what was so important, because I really think the show lives and dies on like the chemistry between the band at the heart of it and all the actors. So, you know, we had quite extensive chemistry tests. And, you know, when I found this group of actors, I really, you know, it was so exciting for me, because I had lived with these characters for so long, and I'd, I had been kind of just shaping them from women that I know and I love. So the kind of thrill of finding these incredible performers who could just inhabit all the complexities of these women was really overwhelming. I remember like the first day when we shot in the bedsit with the whole band, with Amina there, everyone there. And you know, it was the costume and the art design and these amazing actors like inhabiting the characters. I was just like crying. I was like a wreck. I was in the corner. I'm like, I'm happy. These are happiness tears. This is not bad. Because it was just so overwhelming to have it realized in this beautiful way.
I imagine. And you, so you guys learned how to play your instruments then?
Right.
Right. And Momtaz, I guess you just watched.
Very much enjoyed and marveled at their talent and how much they grew and managed to own these instruments. I think at the start, when I was watching their rehearsals, they were like, does that sound okay? How do we look? And I was like, guys, you don't understand. You're a fully fledged band now, whether you like it or not. It's happened.
Yeah. Well, and so much of the punk aesthetic is like DIY, like make it up as you go.
Right.
Maybe these instruments are bad. Like maybe we're doing this badly, but it doesn't really matter. Right. Yeah. So tell me a little bit about how you bonded with your instruments.
For me, I make music, but I very much like produce and sing. So I'd never ever like been behind like an actual real life acoustic drum kit. And it was genuinely like someone was like, here are the drumsticks, here's the therapy, get it all out there, babe, get it all out there. Like, because I literally go in, like imagine like usually I'm in front of like a laptop screen for like 5 hours making one drum sound like a little bit crispier. Whereas like here I'd be like feeling like some Phil, I don't know, I was gonna say Phil Collins, but maybe that's embarrassing. But yeah, it was really cathartic. And I feel like once you like kind of fail together and make music together and see each other in all of those different states, you actually like, by the time we actually came to shoot, like what could we possibly be embarrassed about at this point? Like we're essentially friends.
Because I play acoustic guitar, but I'd never actually picked up the electric before. So, and I think Amina is more accomplished on the guitar than I am in real life. So I had to brush up on that. But also in terms of playing it like someone who plays punk, I think it had to be like, how does Amina rock out? Is it very different from how the other characters who are genuinely cool rock out? So I had to sort of do it in a kind of weird way. So I think I was trying to like, hold the guitar up really high, the electric guitar, like how all the folk musicians would hold it up there. So she'd hold the electric guitar up there, which was kind of a weird way to play, but I think it brought the comedy to how Amina's version of rocking out, basically. Yeah.
Yeah, I love. Yeah.
I didn't get, I I got cast like 2 weeks before we started rehearsal.
Yeah. Right, yeah.
And they just sent a bass to my house. And so I was like, cool, I'll take this. And I started doing rehearsals with Shez over Zoom. So I'd do like an hour a day over Zoom and then like 4 or 5 hours on my own, like intensely practicing every single day. Because I was like, what the heck? And I'm just a bit of a perfectionist. So I was like, I am not going in there and being the person that they have to like shoot around because I haven't got it. So that was like, so it was so funny. It was so interesting. But as the girls say, we got into rehearsals. We were rehearsing with each other like every single day. Like Ange gave everybody her guitar picks. We figured out which guitar picks were the best for our instruments. And then every time somebody played something good, we'd be like, yeah, that's the one. Like everyone was just, oh, these girls are just, it's the most supportive bubble to be in. So it helped. I think that I was able to thrive on the bass because I was surrounded by them. It was cool. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And then we definitely tried to take it a step further, because like once we got our instruments and we could play them like slightly well, we were like, okay, now tricks. Like I was obsessed with like holding my pick like the best way. Like I had to be between two fingers, you know. I'm not a three finger girl. And then Juliette with her tricks on the stage.
I felt so bad because literally at one point I went into the rehearsal with Shez, right, and I literally was like, you know, I've had enough of the drums. You need to teach me how to twirl that stick in between my fingers so that I can look cool. And I can't, like, I'm actually embarrassed to say that that took me much longer than the actual.
But it's in the show, though. It's in the show.
There were a lot of takes of Juliette dropping the stick.
Oh my God, so embarrassing.
But we got the take.
Like every 5 seconds, like midway through shooting, there would be like a massive smash in the background and everyone would be like, Juliette, stop doing that.
There was also one song that we recorded where Juliette lost a drumstick and just played one-handed.
The other hand was like a bongo drum.
Yeah, the other hand was just like this. It was like a mess. It was a mess.
Brilliant. Very calm.
But you can't cheat the drums. The thing is, like, if the camera's coming towards me and if I forget, I'm just gonna move away from the camera. The drums, you cannot escape. Oh. I think, like, you know, Juliet had the hardest job for sure. And Faith, who literally learned it like yesterday.
So. for me as someone who liked punk growing up, I felt like the line where Amina, where Noor is making fun of Amina's Don McLean poster, and she's like, you just have some white man on your wall. Yeah. And Amina's like, he's not white, he's Don McLean.
Yes.
And I felt like I really vibed with that because I think there's this interesting phenomenon with like being in the diaspora where like you end up claiming certain artists as your own. And I feel like with music in particular, that's so powerful. Yeah. I'd love to hear a little bit about the music that you guys like loved growing up, because I think that's like so important for the show.
I mean, I'm straight up Whitney, Aretha, obsessive. And every time I used to sing in like gospel choirs and stuff, they'd be like, you're too loud. And yesterday I was watching the TV like, am I too loud now? Because I'm like, in a podcast, like, I knew I had a loud voice for something. Mm-hmm. So yeah, I was straight up Whitney. Literally all the like female soulful singers, obsessive.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I'm gonna lay it all on the table here. I was straight up an emo.
Yeah.
As you can, do you know what I mean? Clearly it's not a phase that I managed to grow out of. But yeah, I was an emo, and then I was like into like a lot of indie stuff, and then kind of everything. I don't know, I feel like growing up in London, you end up getting quite like an eclectic music around you anyway. So like growing up, there was just a lot of like, you know, like dancehall around and like Afrobeat and stuff. So yeah. Like, I feel like there's just so much, like living in London, you really get like you have like a rich kind of tapestry of music that you have all around you.
Yeah.
Sorry, okay.
Well, no, please, Sarah, go ahead.
I was going to say, mine was very, very eclectic because my dad really liked, I know it's really weird to say, but world music. I mean, it's not world music. We know it, you know.
Yeah.
But I grew up listening to a lot of panpipes and, like, soundscapes and stuff like that. So when I got to
a lot of sense.
But when I went to sixth form, people couldn't understand that I didn't know like popular music. So like for my birthday, everyone brought like a DAB radio and they were like, you're only allowed to listen to music, like one extra for like
months.
You only know pan pipes. Pan pipes are cool. Shut up.
Pan pipes are cool.
Thank
you. Did you like fall into like a weird fever afterwards and then like wake up out of it being like, I love pop.
Yeah. No, I did fall in love with other artists, but the pan pipes will be my first love.
Oh, I love that.
I was very much like Amina, what, like all the sensitive singer-songwriter stuff, all the American folk, Johnny Cash and Joan Baez and all of those people. Just, you know, three chords and it's all about the storytelling. It's like that kind of vibe. That's what I fell in love with.
I grew up with like soul music, like Motown, Marvin Gaye, like Stevie Wonder is like the ultimate for me. And also like Beyonce, like I used to play Destiny's Child with my sister and my cousins and I would never get to be Beyonce, which it still irks me now because that's why I'm bringing it up. And I imagine Montaz, who wants to have this record, because I like R&B and hip hop, so obviously very different to punk, but still expressive. And Montaz's dream is to have this record label. So I think like Roc Nation, Jay-Z, Bad Boy Records, P Diddy, like Dr. Dre, like I think she's that. I think she's, her label's gonna be so eclectic.
Yeah.
And it's gonna rival Roc Nation.
Yeah.
I think you have a concrete goal.
Yeah.
Like, you're exactly where it's going.
I see it.
One of the things, it's sort of coming through in your different music tastes too. One of the things I liked about the group is that it has some of those like classic group dynamics where everyone's sort of a little bit of a, has like a type to them. I feel like it's sort of unfair to compare everything to Sex and the City when like the Golden Girls, for example, does it too, or like, you know, like the Sailor Moon anime has like the different characters that are all sort of like different types. But I definitely felt some of that from this and I was curious like, I was curious if you guys felt that too, like that you were sort of like playing a, not exactly like a stereotype, but kind of like an archetype, if that makes sense.
I feel like we're spicy Spice Girls.
Yeah, that's it.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, for sure.
So when I wrote it, it's interesting that you mentioned Sex and the City, but for me, what I absolutely am obsessed with and like, can't get enough of is band dynamics in movies. So if this is Spinal Tap or Almost Famous, it's actually the egos of, you know, often these sort of male groups where it's like, why am I not at the front? Or like the tensions, the rivalries. And oftentimes what I love is it's essentially band dynamics and the kind of all these artists' personalities like clashing against each other. And oftentimes like that was how initially I grounded each of the characters as like, who are they in this band and who do they bump against? Who do they ally with? And that for me was quite an exciting starting point. Actually, rather than thinking of something like Sex and the City, it was more like, this is Spinal Tap.
I love that.
I do think we all have our like different band persona. Like when we step onto stage and start playing, we kind of either it's an extension of what we're like or we change. Because Bisma in herself is nothing like Bisma when she's performing. Like when she's performing, she's a different person. It's like, you okay, hun? But when she's off, like when she's not on stage, she's so zen and really calm and trying to keep everything in. And then she gets to just let loose when she's on the mic. So yeah, it is. But then Sarah, yours is an extension when you start singing, I guess.
Yeah, but she's definitely different.
Yeah, when she
sits back a lot more, yeah. But when we're on the mics, it's just
It's like level 300.
Yeah, but it's so nice because within the band, although we do have our archetypal kind of positions, you realise there's lots that we do share, as in like it's written by everyone, it's managed by Montaz, but we also debate about who's going to put in the next person or do the next thing. So it's good. So it does bounce back and forth where you're like, oh no, hang on. Who's in charge here? And that's a problem for Syrah.
And a problem for
It's a problem for Aisha.
It's impossible to imagine the band being four Syrahs, or four Aishas. Like, you know, you need to have the balance of these strong personalities. I guess I could see four Bismas. Bisma seems a lot more chill.
I don't know how much they get done. I think they just sit and drink.
So one of the things that I loved about it, I'm not Muslim myself, but I'm aware that there's so many different ways to practice it. And I think one of the things that really spoke to me about all of the women is that in these really subtle ways that are not super telegraphed or on the nose, you can see all of the differences in how they practice and what they're where their families might be from, like geographically. And I kind of wanted to talk a little bit about that, about some of those decisions, because I just thought that they were really, really powerful, honestly. So for example, like Lucy's character Mumtaz wears a niqab, which is like a specific type of thing. And then both Amina and Aisha are wearing hijabs, but I think they're, you can see how different they are based on how they style their hijabs. And so I was curious if, I know some of this stuff is mentioned in the show, but was wondering if we could talk a little bit about where those characters are from and why they might be wearing the specific head coverings that they are, or why they might be choosing not to, if you guys have thought about that. And if you haven't, if it's still maybe that's for season two, then don't worry about it. That's fine too.
That is such an interesting question, and something that I was so excited to show on screen, if, as you say, different ways of expressing yourself as a Muslim woman. With the question of Mumtaz wearing a niqab, there's an artist friend of mine who is a niqabi, and we talked at length, and one thing I was really excited to do was actually not reveal very much of her ever through the show, because I wanted, and this is one thing we discussed, to by the end of the show, you love her and you haven't really seen her face and you can still know her. Again, as a way of pushing back against this idea that if a woman wears a niqab, she's somehow in other, different, inaccessible, we can't connect to her, and especially in Europe, sometimes you have this sort of pressure for women to take off their niqab and be one of us and join the fold, when actually, no, she can be who she is in her full self. And we fall in love with her as a character, and we don't need to see her face. We hear her, we see her eyes, we get so much from that. And that was something that I was thinking about and was really excited to do. Yeah. In terms of the other characters, and Aisha's expression with her hijab was also something I was really, really keen to show. When Aisha's in the bedsit with the band, that's her kind of domain of sisterhood, and where they all can be themselves, and where you see this Juliette's glorious mane of hair where she's with her sisters rocking out. And then when she's living her life on the street as an Uber driver, she's got this sort of slick look. Mm-hmm. And I'm sure you guys can speak to this, but our costume designer PC Williams and all of us kind of worked really closely together to decide what's the style, who are they, how would they wear their hijab. There was such a lot of time spent really tailoring the looks to each of the characters, because I wanted them to look badass and rad, because this is ultimately a celebration of these women. They are people that I love, and I have drawn from people that I love, and I wanted to show them as awesome, beautiful, wonderful people. Oh my gosh, I'm just hearing myself. I'm like,
it's all good. I love it.
If I might jump in as well, I think with Amina's best friend, Noor, because she's got this friendship group that's very separate from the band with the university friends. And with Noor, every time you see Noor, she has a different style of hijab. And for her, it's very much an expressive thing. It's not just her identity, it's the way she expresses her fashion and her sense of style. And I love that. And I love the detail that next to her, because, Amina is not as fashion forward. Her way of wearing the hijab is very, very practical. And the one time you see her wear it in something that's sort of close to a bit more sort of fashionable is because you realize that she's going on a date and Noor has clearly styled it for her. And it's never explained, but you just know, because the first person she calls in the middle of the date is Noor to be how the date is going. But one of the most moving things, I think, about the show, and it's never, as you say, telegraphed or signposted, it's just an observation, is how Amina's mum doesn't wear one, but she does. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And it's just this beautiful expression of like the fact that faith is so personal. And it's, and I love that you never explain why Amina chose to wear the headscarf. It's not, there's no, you know, there's never a moment where any of the characters have any kind of crisis of faith. They're very secure in how they believe. And I think that's actually one of the most moving things about the show for me.
Yeah. Yeah. I think, yeah, just to like literally jump off that point as well, I think it's so rare where we see a show where like a character or even like any person, like being a Muslim is just like accepted as fact and not like endlessly explained or justified or validated. And I think what TV needs is really just a lot more kind of representations that are like that, and that, that aren't kind of just like about dissecting every single part and it being this kind of like kitchen sink narrative of like a crisis of faith, and to actually show no, like it's not that the Muslim is the descriptor of the kind of person that you are. It's just like an addition and like another like gorgeous layer to the kind of person that you can be, as opposed to like this all defining character trait. Whereas in fact, like if you look at life and like the variety of life, you see that kind of variety in all communities. So like, it's important, I think, that that shows. And I think the fact that it does in the costume as well and in those details is just so heartwarming to me.
Yeah, all of the characters have so much agency. And I think that that's something that like often women are, I mean, it's hard for women in general, let alone Muslim women in television or in film, to have that much interiority, you know, for like their characters to be written in such a way where you can see their choices and respect that they made them, as opposed to have them being imposed upon them. But I think that's like very, it's so obvious in this show. And what I loved about it too, you know, we get a glimpse with all the characters of what their family dynamics are, and how, as you said, Anjana, about Amina's character, like her mom doesn't wear the hijab, but clearly her choice is also like a part of their dynamic. Like there's these interesting stories are being played out in the background, yeah. But because they all care about the band so much, the story's about the band, which I really enjoyed. Because I think for a lot of immigrant communities, especially when you're young, when you're in your teens or in university, these are not things you're like fully conscious of, like the battles that you're fighting or the tensions you're sort of trying to like smoothen out in your life. So I appreciated that. That was not a question, unfortunately. That was just me. I do have other questions though. One, Nida, you touched on this a little bit, which is I know that you said so specifically with Lucie when you were doing Mumtaz, like we don't ever like fully see her face, but we do see her hair once or twice. And then for both Aisha and Amina, who are hijabi, we see their hair at some point. So we enter like kind of their intimate space, kind of their home space. I was curious about the decision to bring the camera into their intimate space. And I think like I can totally see the appeal for it, but it's interesting, for example, that like in, you know, in band practice, Aisha does take off her hijab, Amina doesn't take off her hijab, Mumtaz doesn't take off her niqab, even though they're in kind of like an intimate sort of sisterhood space. And then when they perform, you know, even though they're kind of bringing that intimate sisterhood like to their fans, you know, they're wearing all of their sort of like public. So I was curious a little bit about that.
Yeah, you know, these were questions that I was always asking and wondering. And for me, you know, just from my experience of friends, if you've done your hijab and it looks dope, you're not necessarily going to unpick it. Right. Like for others, it's like, boom, let's go. So again, it was trying to speak to them in that moment. And, you know, in terms of like going into their houses, because I wanted the audience to, you know, with Amina's character, who's sort of, it's her sort of journey of self-discovery, that we go in and we get to know her and we get to sort of be close to her. And it was just something that I really wanted to kind of allow the audience to have that kind of closeness to the character. And also, you know, with Aisha's character, with Juliette's character, Aisha, one of the things that I really wanted to do is, you know, you see, for example, oh, I don't know if are we allowed to do spoilers, like spoiler stuff? Probably not. But anyway, there's somebody who Aisha becomes close to, and then when you see her being with her, with this person not in her hijab, it's like this, oh, she's let this person in.
Right.
So it's, again, subtle ways to show closeness. And again, it's not always like, oh, for each woman, they'll feel comfortable to have it off or on. It's, again, differences, and allowing for those differences to be, it was something that I was really into.
Yeah. I have one more question on that. Well, I sort of have to sort of start winding down because we're in like the last like 10-ish minutes. But I think that one of the tensions that's so fascinating that gets explored in interesting ways, like in the very first scene, I think Amina says music is haram, or maybe the person she's talking to says music is haram. And I think all of the characters have anger and frustration that they're channeling in different ways. And whether or not that anger and frustration has to do with their ethnicity, their tradition, their religion is not necessarily clear. Although clearly there's like, as the season goes on, you find out about some backstory and stuff. But I thought that the social media firestorm that happens later in the season, which kind of, it attacks the band for being not good Muslim girls or for saying things that could be construed as being critical of it. And I was a little, I was interested in how the show kind of anticipates some of the, some of it, like the dialogue perhaps, but also maybe like kind of neutralizes it by bringing it up. And I was sort of, I was curious, like if that was something that felt important to the rest of you, like engaging with this dialogue ahead of time, or if that's like a fear that's come up, is like being the subject of a firestorm. I know that everything is sort of a social media firestorm, so I don't know if it like, and what I sort of loved that in the show, I guess this is not exactly a spoiler, that the firestorm has like negative and positive consequences, so it's like, okay, like it's fine, but yeah, I was interested in that because I do think there is a live wire there to be hit if you know, if it's there, if it's available. Mm-hmm.
You know, for me, writing it, it was less about anticipating or like, you know, beating it to the punch. It was more about, you know, Amina's character is someone who we see struggle with acceptance and wanting to fit in. And, you know, we see her having to, I'd say, kind of hide aspects of herself to try and gain acceptance, you know, with a certain group. So for me, I was like, what could take her to the darkest place? And that is, you know, something like a social media storm where it feels like the world is shaming you.
Mm-hmm.
And then to see her come back from that was so exciting for me. And I realized as I, you know, I've been doing a few Q&As and stuff, and one of the questions that comes up for me often from, you know, young women of color, Muslim women, is how do you have the courage to speak when your auntie, your uncle, you know, the TL will come for you? And it's, again, it was important for me to take these characters to that dark place to then also say, you know, you may not please everyone, but your voice is worth speaking and worth hearing. And that was one of the messages I really felt quite passionate about. You know, as women of color, oftentimes you get a lot of heat for being who you are. And I really wanted the show to go there with these characters, also because it allowed me to like see the darkness, you know, push them and to see these Muslim women, you know, behave in cruel ways, in dark ways, and be complex, and was just also exciting on the one hand, but then to also say, you know what, even when not everyone loves you, your voice is still valid, is something that, as a message for me, is very important. And yeah, that's me saying, that's what I have to say.
that's just why I love the show so much, and I think it will be so impactful on a universal level. I just think about all the kids and all the little girls and just everybody who just feels a bit different to everybody else, and just
who gets judged for just existing, just for being. And by the time you get to that point in the story, you've fallen in love with all these girls in all their differences and all their idiosyncrasies. And you know when this person's going to flip out, you know when this person's going to panic, you know what makes them who they are, and you love them, and you realize that people are just going to judge them no matter what, just because they're different, just because they exist. And like Nida was saying, it's such an inspiring thing for just little kids who can grow up, or just maybe even people who were shackled down by that all their lives, that they can just go, I'm just gonna be me. I'm just gonna live out my life and know that there are other people who feel the same way. There's a sisterhood, there's a lady parts for all of us. There's like a group of people that will just accept us for who we are, regardless of, you know, faith, gender, ethnicity, anything. There are people who understand you on a heart level. I think that's just that's what really excites me about the show.
I felt watching it, this is a different topic, I felt watching it really reminded of Scott Pilgrim versus the World. First of all, love that, like, adore that movie. And even the band name, We Are Sex Bomb and We Are Lady Parts. So I was just curious if there was like an, and then, you know, a lot of the editing and direction is a little bit like Edgar Wright too. So I was kind of curious, I wanted to ask if that was a direct reference. Not, no worries if not. I think there's like a cool vibe to it regardless.
No, thank you. That's such a compliment. You know, there's a lot of influences in the show, as I'm sure also you have picked up my concept. Riffing on stuff, you know, Edgar Wright is such a dope director. I think he uses the camera in a way that often comedy directors don't bring in that second, that sort of element as a means to accentuate and, you know, enjoy the comedy. You know, there's I have so many references. You know, I also love the Coen brothers in how they use rhythm in comedy, and there's music in the show, but you'll see these actors are musical, so there's rhythm in how they move, there's rhythm in how they speak, and they bounce off each other. And even in the casting, it's like musicality doesn't stop at just the instruments, it's also in the comedy. It's all about timing, and that's what I think really, you know, elevated the show, is how these actors really kind of were able to riff off each other, bounce and move together. They were like moving as a unit sometimes. I was like, whoa, this has just gone to another level. I also like, you know, I love films from the 1940s, like American sort of, you know, All About Eve is one of my favorite films. And again, dialogue till I die. I'm obsessed with kind of bam, 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 quick fire dialogue. But yeah, I feel like obviously this is Spinal Tap, the best film ever made, possibly, I don't know. Band movies are my fave. So yeah, there's a lot of stuff I was drawing on, but yeah, it's really cool that you think it, like, you know, to be even like sort of considered near Scott Pilgrim is great, because I love that movie too.
Well, this is perfect for me, because as like an American too, I'm like, it's like Scott Pilgrim, but they all talk like Bendit like Beckham.
Oh my God.
It's like a very powerful combination. You know, that just, it means a lot. Yeah.
Crazy. All kinds of, like, people are like, oh, it's like Lady Bird meets Guy Ritchie. That's something. All right, I'll go with it.
Someone we spoke to said that it reminded them of Dairy Girls, actually.
Yeah.
Wow. Yeah. And I thought, given it's a different community, but like super zoomed in, I could kind of.
Yeah. Unfortunately for Americans, it's like all the same over there. I'm so sorry. we're terrible. I think that's just one of the things that I love so much about this is, you know, the bands that you love are so close to your heart. And a lot of us grew up with bands that didn't look like us, but still spoke to us. And for being able to see that, like, that fandom, like, has a story and then and has, like, meaning in that way is just, like, so exciting and so cool. I totally think it's going to speak to a lot of people who are young now, but I think also people who grew up with music that was different, I think they're gonna remember it in an instant, you know, what it was like to be like that. So yeah.
Yay.
Well, thank you guys so much for doing this. This was super fun. I'm really excited for people to watch the show. I think this was the cool hair club, I would say. That was the, you know, I did my part, you know, or whatever I could, but I just feel like we all like really represented, and I think that that's important.
Thank you.
You're so welcome.